Oh, wait, my movie was Videodrome by David Cronenberg.
Oh, my
Arrow
God.
Films.
There we go.
There you go. And I was jealous that last movie I didn't get to wear a proton pack or a flight suit. And now I feel complete. And I'm ready to move forward into the next movie, just fully suited up all the time.
There's such a treasure trove. And the thing is that we kind of carry all of that with us when we come to set. So it's the most surreal and incredible thing to sit around and kind of work with them.
Ghostbusters. According to these hacks, they saved the world.
Our characters are very new to it still, and so I'd love to see them sort of be very sort of comfortable and very used to it, you know? Like it's just a job.
Buster makes me feel good. Makes me feel good.
One of them just might deliver a line or say something and it's improvised or whatever. And it's like, oh my God, I feel like I'm in a Bill Murray movie.
It was very interesting and fun to be able to play Phoebe losing her mind, trying to figure out what to do, and making new friends and connections.
Carrie, I have to ask you, I remember interviewing you last time for this movie and for the last one, and you told me that you were a huge Ghostbusters fan from back in the day. So what was it like for you, first time you suited up, strapped on the proton pack, and got ready to fight ghosts?
Oh man, I have to be honest, it still doesn't really feel real. I mean, I've now seen the movie, but it never stops feeling surreal, honestly. And I was jealous that last movie I didn't get to wear a proton pack or a flight suit, and now I feel complete, and I'm ready to move forward into the next movie, just fully suited up all the time.
Paul, I was listening to a podcast with Patton Oswalt, and he was talking about how in between scenes, you guys would sometimes go and talk to Dan Aykroyd, because he had all these amazing stories.
Yeah.
And I have to imagine working with him and Ernie Hudson and Bill Murray and Annie Potts, you must have been crazy entertained between takes, right?
Absolutely. I mean, they're all such great people, and they're fun to hang out with. And finally, the great thing about working on this one was, and this isn't always the case on film sets, we all really sat together. They set up chairs all together in a tent, and no one really brought their phones around, so we would talk in between lighting setups. And over time, I think we all got brave enough to ask a question. And I remember vividly asking Dan Aykroyd, how did Blues Brothers really start? And then what was Belushi like? Mm. And then tell me about the bar that you guys had your SNL after parties at. How did that come about? And it kind of set up this, there was just a chain reaction. All of us were asking questions to these legends and hearing stories about movies and shows that we've grown up with our, you know, favorite people, like these icons. And so it was the most incredible experience. Asking them about Ghostbusters.
Yeah.
You know, just everything.
For the first time in New York history, a room full of people froze to death in July.
It's an unimaginable evil. It's the power to kill by fear itself.
Like, literally scared to death?
So, McKenna, I gotta ask you, since the last movie, Phoebe's arc is kind of interesting with her being sidelined by that classic Ghostbusters villain, Walter Peck. What can you tell me about where Phoebe's at in the sequel as opposed to the original?
Well, I mean, like you said, this go-around, well, she's a little bit older, but she gets sidelined. She's more comfortable in what she's doing. I mean, the film opens with the family busting ghosts. It seems like something they're comfortable, used to doing. They pass a police car and they're like, they've got it. They do this for a living. And then Phoebe immediately gets benched. And so her entire arc is just kind of figuring out, what do I do with myself? How do I continue to do what I love? How can I prove myself to people who, you know, don't really... It's not that they don't believe in her, but won't let her do what she's good at because of her age. So it was very interesting and fun to be able to play Phoebe losing her mind, trying to figure out what to do, and making new friends and connections.
Nice. And Ben, I have to ask you, you get to do one of the iconic Ghostbusters things here, getting slimed by Slimer. So what can you tell me about that day?
It was great. It was the first day on set, so it kind of like set the tone of, I feel like, the rest of the shoot. And that was so fun. It was like I had to get sort of slime squibbed, and it was super fun. It was all like practical, and obviously other than like Slimer flying around, which is impossible, it was a really fun day.
I've been waiting 40 years for this. They called themselves Ghostbusters. According to these hacks, they saved the world. No eyewitnesses. And who is found to carry the torch? Descendants of Egon Spengler.
Harry, our biggest trending story of the last week has been when you mentioned that you and your husband have 10,000 Blu-rays, and I would be remiss not to ask you about it. We're huge advocates of physical media here, and I was just wondering if you could weigh in on that, because I love physical media.
Oh, yes. You know, I guess I didn't understand what we would be losing with streaming. I mean, Tracy really did educate me about the fact that so many of these films are now completely inaccessible if you don't own them yourself. And of course, there are all these companies putting out new imprints of sort of original films and doing beautiful work. And some of them are really small companies and they need support. And so Tracy is an avid supporter of all of these companies. And we've amassed this incredible collection. Like I say, he's kind of a sick man. But I've really come to value it. And I've learned a lot about film just because of the collection in my own basement. And one of the amazing arrangements of our marriage is that I go down there with him and he chooses what we watch, and I never decide. So every night for me is a surprise. It's like not knowing the gender of your child. It's amazing. It's so fun.
A good one.
What was the last thing you watched?
Oh my gosh, he's gonna kill me because I'm always, he's like, what did we watch last night? I'm like, I tweeted it. What was the last thing I tweeted?
Oh,
because I was home a couple days ago. I gotta look at my Twitter feed. Okay. I can't remember because I've now been on press junket days.
Paul, one question for you. So let's say the next these movies are kind of geared towards bringing in a new generation of Ghostbusters fans. So presumably these people are going to go back and they're going to watch the old Ghostbusters movies. After they watch those, if they wanted to watch any Dan Aykroyd or Bill Murray movie, which one would you say would be the next go-to for them to
watch? Oh, man.
Putting you on the spot. I know.
Yeah, I mean, that's a real tough. I love so many of them. I might say Stripes, because of also the Harold Ramis connection there.
Sure.
I mean, you could also do Groundhog Day because of the Ramis connection there too. But I'd be like, or Caddyshack. I mean, my God, there's so many. Caddyshack. It's impossible to say. You know, like, God, and with Aykroyd, Blues Brothers obviously is such a major.
All the old SCTV stuff though is so funny.
Oh yeah,
that's great stuff.
Okay. Well, you've got all that. Then you can say like, "Are you like Rick Moranis? You think he's funny? Look
oh
at this."
Oh my God, Rick Moranis.
And I mean,
at best.
There's such a treasure trove. And the thing is that we kind of carry all of that with us when we come to set. Mm-hmm. So it's the most surreal and incredible thing to sit around and kind of work with them.
Yeah.
Because every once in a while, even during a take, one of them just might deliver a line or say something and it's improvised or whatever. And it's like, oh my God, I feel like I'm in a Bill Murray movie. Mm-hmm. Not just like working with him, but the way he'll say something with a proud of you now, a proud of you then, proud of you now. Like he says something about Dan Aykroyd's
or an character. Annie Potts line delivery, which
and,
I love.
And it's just like a blast from the past. It's like that is exactly the guy who said that in Caddyshack, or that's the guy who said it in Blues Brothers. You hear the intonations, and it's like and in those moments, you just turn into like a 10-year-old, and it's just electric.
Buddy, you just hit the jackpot.
What is it?
Better question is, what's inside of it?
When you guys were promoting Afterlife, you couldn't really talk about the fact that you got to interact with the original Ghostbusters, but now it's less of a secret. And I was just wondering, so what was it like suiting up opposite Bill Murray, Ernie Hudson, Dan Aykroyd, and Annie Potts? It must have been crazy.
Yeah, I mean, you... It's so, I don't know.
You never get used to it.
You never get used to it. It's really incredible. To be, like, among them with the costume on and everything is is like a, it's an honor, but it's super surreal.
Anyway, okay, going forward into the franchise, what do you what would you like to see happen for your characters? Because I could see you guys kind of spinning off and doing your own thing in like kind of into like a solo adventure. Do you think that there's room for that in the Ghostbusters franchise going forward? Because it feels like they want to kind of branch off into a couple of different directions into more of kind of an expanded franchise, right?
Yeah, I mean, if we do another one, I'd love to just see like kind of nonstop ghostbusting, you know, like in this movie, obviously, there's a lot of, you know, sort of, because, you know, we're setting up a new villain and we have, like, the new cast and stuff, there's also, like, a lot of sort of, like, you know, lore and stuff like that and, like, learning about the world that we're
unraveling
in.
Unraveling the mystery of Garaka.
Exactly. And it'd be cool to just see, like, you know, like, that opening scene, if you've seen the film, is, like, so fun. Yeah. And, like, to see that kind of through the whole, like, having that sequence, you know, just, like, nonstop, I think would be so fun. yeah, and, like, just the idea that, like, our characters are so, you know, they really treat it like their job. Because this one, like, in this one, like, our characters are very new to it still. And so I'd love to see them sort of be very sort of comfortable and, like, very used to it, you know, like it's just a job.
So I think like, thanks, fun. Finn. Very expensive idea.
Yeah, exactly.
Non-stop action
yeah.
sequence.
I just want to see non-stop action. Yeah.